Today is Tuesday, March 21st, 2017. Got producer Sam in today. I was just telling him I love giving people bad news. Let me volunteer to be that guy. There's nothing funnier than your buddy coming up to you and saying, "Hey man, meet my chick. Isn't she cool?" And then you go, "Oh man, I gotta tell you something. Last week, I love breaking bad news." How about you, Sam?
I am the birth of the bearer of bad news.
Yeah?
I try to find different ways of doing it, whether it's a very sarcastic way or a very serious way. I thrive in those type of those moments.
I want to be the guy that goes, "So, you know that chicken that you ate? Well, I saw mom drop that shit on the floor." Stuff like that. I want to be that guy. Why are they talking about sandwiches on ESPN so much today? Is that like National Sandwich Day or something?
It might be. If it is, then that's a good look. I actually had to tell a girl she had a STD.
You had to tell her?
I had to tell her because I worked at a hospital.
Okay.
Came to get her results. Yeah, no. I
thought you were telling her, like, "Hey, guess what?" Her.
Yeah. Thanks for raw dogging me. Now, guess what? Guess what STD you have?
Before you leave,
multiple
can we talk?
Choice.
Wow. That's got to be rough.
Yeah, it was rushed. She was 18, man. It was really
18.
It was really awkward. 18, bro. 18. Beautiful young girl. She gave me the whole story leading up to it, and then I got her results, and I was just like, "Oh." So I had to be Mr. Professional and talk very clinically and give her advice and all of that type of stuff. So, good times.
Man, I don't know if I could do that one.
That was tough. But like I said, I thrive in those moments, but I couldn't be sarcastic. I couldn't be an asshole in that moment. I had to be like serious, consoling, big brother kind of guy.
Mm-hmm.
I'm about 30 seconds away.
What's a dumb question you get repeatedly?
In this job?
Yeah.
Have I met Howard Stern? That's normally the question. 10 seconds. Here we go.
This is your captain speaking. We are making our descent into Las Vegas McCarran Airport. On behalf of our crew, we'd like to thank you for flying MMAjunkie Airlines. Now please fasten your seatbelts and put your tray tables in your upright position, because the descent is going to be a little bit bumpy.
Hi, Junkie Nation. It's time to roll, baby, on MMAjunkie Radio with Gorgeous George and Gold. This is what we do and why we do it, baby. All night long, we rollin'!
The MMA Junkie Radio revolution is upon us.
Can you dig it?
There's no escape.
No escape.
Through the vast frontier of cyberspace, and through a sea of stars in outer space.
One small step for man, one giant leap for mankind.
We've solidified our combat communication stranglehold.
We are controlling transmission.
With the use of MMA Junkie Radio and SiriusXM satellite radio technology.
MMA Junkie Radio, commence transmission.
Live from MMA Junkie Radio HQ in the fight capital of the world, Las Vegas, Nevada. Here are your hosts, Gorgeous George and Go.
From the fight capital of the world, inside the beautiful Mandalay Bay Racing Sportsbook, you are listening to the MMA Junkie Radio Show. I'm your host, Gorgeous George. With me, as always, is the devious and dastardly Go's, our East co-host, and back east, handling all the producing duties today, is Sam. What's up, guys?
What up? How you doing?
Doing all right. Doing all right. You know what put me in a good mood late last night before I went to bed and has carried over to this morning?
No.
Champ Camp 3.
Champ Camp, you like that?
Yeah.
It's fun to watch.
He released two versions before the fight. The last few days, he released a third version, which it surprised me. I didn't know. I didn't know that it was out there. And, yeah, I guess I can say it. Towards the end of, have you seen it?
I haven't seen it, no.
Towards the end of Champ Cam 3, he gives the belt to somebody.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah. And you know what's sad? Here's the one part that was slightly sad was people are going to say that he trying to be like Cody, you know, like that deal.
Oh,
rather than
on.
Focus on the positive. So there's a lady who, I'm talking about Tyron Woodley. He does a series called Champ Camp before his fights. And they're really good. They're well produced. And they cover him as he prepares throughout his camp for his fights. I think I've seen Lawler, Thompson 1, Thompson 2. I think he's done three of them. So they're like an embedded on just Tyron Woodley. And they don't last just fight week. They last throughout the camp. There you go. I think that's the best way I can put it. Usually about 20 minutes long. And I've talked about this before because I caught the first one, all three of them, after the fight. But I still had fun going back and just seeing him piece it together. But once I was aware of him, I've looked out for him. And so I caught the first two. And then in this one goes, as he is doing stuff around T-Mobile and all the MGM properties, you know, how they have media days and scrums and this and that. He comes across a lady who said she was inspired by Tyron. And her family didn't think she'd go out and follow her dreams of just moving away, really, and getting a job and doing things on her own. But she was a fan of Tyron, and she shared that with him. And that was like midweek. And then towards the end, I think it's the night that he won, or maybe the next night, I can't tell. He sees her again, has a sidebar. Boom, he goes, I'd like to give you something. Gives her the belt.
Damn. That's pretty cool.
It was cool. It really was cool.
So
and
for
yes,
people that don't know, you when you get a belt, I think you get up to five of them, right?
I think so, yeah.
Yeah, so every time you show up, you defend your belt, they hand you a new one.
So he should have three right now. And he gave one to the young lady, which means he has two. And I think in one of the champ camps, you see that one's at his gym. So I'm not sure where the other one is. But it was cool.
And there is a way to tell the real belt from the replica belt.
Right.
Yeah, they look sure the same on the outside. But on the inside, there's a little thing you can catch.
Right. And it's what allows Dana to be so smooth when he places the belt around him. Because it's not just a quick snap and then it's on. There's some hooks and Velcro and whatever. But anyway, I thought, wow, what a great way to just cap off my evening. Had a nice evening. Went to my buddy's bar, Jason Straub. Remember him?
Mm-hmm.
Remember him, Goose?
I remember him.
He told me on the way out. He goes, tell Goose. I said, hello again. He knows where I'm at. Sure would be nice to see him. He actually said that. But anyway, I hadn't seen him in a while. So I went to his bar, hung out, and then came home. I had to do the rankings, you know, start things off. I'm already getting feedback from John Morgan, but there wasn't really much to move around. Manua fought Anderson, you know, Corey Anderson, and he really can't go up because Gustafson's ahead. If you want to track and follow USA Today Sports, MMA Junkie, we do the rankings every week, and on the top of MMA Junkie, there's the rankings tab. You can check it out. But the light heavyweight division was featured last week in the main event at UFC Fight Night 107, and Gustafson knocked him out, I think, just about 3 years ago. And Manuel hasn't been a frequent fighter, so it's going to take a little bit more for him to really leapfrog a guy who knocked him out. Mm-hmm. And Gustafson's proven he's one of the better ones. He's lost to the main guys, but he beats everyone else, including Manuel. Anderson, there's really nowhere to go down because he had won 4 or 5 with only one split decision loss to Hua in Brazil, which was controversial, you recall.
Yeah.
So getting beat by Manoa is no shame in that either. So that's just a little taste there in case you are into the rankings and you look forward to it. Wednesday in the paper, we only get top 10 in the paper, but on the website we go 15 deep with some honorable mentions. So there won't be anything there. Gunnar Nelson, same thing, kind of stuck in the HMs. That means he's a 16 through 20 fighter. And we don't just do UFC. We do the whole world, which includes Bellator, ONE FC, Well, no longer one FC, one championship, World Series, yeah, everything else. Andre Harrison, however, I did make a plug for him. I know you don't have it in front of you, and I don't want to put you on the spot, but between Harrison and Choi, believe it or not, I think Harrison's got better stats.
Yeah?
It's hard to believe because Choi's 14-2, and he's coming off a loss to Swanson, so he was this close to having a top 10 win under his belt. But his other wins, they lose a little bit of their flash, pizzazz, as they lose and drop out of the UFC. So carefully looking at Choi's record going into the UFC, I wouldn't say padded. He beat whoever they put in front of him, but we just don't know who they are. When he gets to the UFC, has a decent run, but he's lost twice. Harrison hasn't lost anyone. He's held the Ring of Combat belt, the Titan belt, and the World Series of Fighting belt. But to be outside the UFC and win those three belts, that's impressive. And to be undefeated, that's impressive to me too.
The styles are so night and day that I think sometimes people are attached to that.
Yeah. Yeah. But that was my pitch. The other guys can tell me to get lost. Anyway.
I like it when people, when they're up front and they just say something like that.
Get lost. Get lost.
Beat it, nerd.
Yeah. The Bellator MMA promotion made an announcement. You know, it was slightly teased by Lorenz on our show that something was going to come out as far as New York. And on June 24th, they're headed to New York for a pay-per-view.
Yeah, so this is my question. Who needs to be on that pay-per-view? What matchups need to happen for you to want to pay for it? Let's just put tag of $50. Is that good?
I imagine that's what they'll do.
Okay. Who needs to be on that card for you to order that?
What they've already said, I believe Wanderlei Chael is your main event.
Yeah.
And Mitrione and Fedor is your co-main.
See, I saw something that said that this morning. That doesn't make too much sense to me, but I'll take it.
Bader called out Davis. Davis obliged. So if that matchup's made, there's three big fights.
You need Chandler Gaethje, I think, would be fun.
Chandler Gaethje. But Gaethje goes, we've already established. Remember Ray said he's got one more fight left?
Yeah.
So that puts him in.
But
I think
this is a while.
I think he's going to be in June. The fight's in June, and then after that he becomes a free agent, and then maybe we can entertain that.
MVP? Lorenz? Would they derail one of those guys?
Mm-hmm. But they're getting some nice talent there. So Daly's already fighting McDonald a few weeks before that. Mm-hmm. So the turnaround might be tough. But I would imagine, I suppose at some point, two big names have to fight each other. The danger in it is, look what happened to Chandler. Josh Thompson and Patricio. This was Patricio's comeback fight, if I'm not mistaken, after the Chandler KO. But in San Jose, to me, it looked like a chance to feature Josh Thompson to win, beat Patricio, and then introduce Chandler as his next opponent. And then all of a sudden, if that goes south, what do you have? Chandler's beating Patricio, Benson, and now Thompson took himself out of the sweepstakes momentarily. Now you're left with, like, well, who's the clear number one contender? That's what's scary about if these divisions, you match two guys up. So if one guy takes the other one out and there's an injury or someone leaves the promotion, now you're stuck with now who, you know, and you have to shove a name down our throats that we're just not feeling.
Do you agree with Fedor being the co-main over Wanderlei and Chael?
You know, believe it or not, I think Fedor should be the main.
I think so, too.
I think he's still Fedor. And not that the other two aren't the other two, but Chael's coming off a loss, and Wanderlei, much respect, he's just hasn't fought for, what, 3 years now? Four?
In a while, man.
Yeah. So, luckily, they have carryover heat, but how much is really coming over? I don't know.
They'll build it up.
You know, it would have been nice if maybe they ran into each other at a hallway and, you know, at a previous belt or some little footage spills out. Something like that would have reminded us of that rivalry, that fight that was supposed to happen. So I think I would have went with Fedor and Matt Mitrione. Mitrione's got a big name from the UFC. The fight was supposed to happen. If I'm not mistaken, there's a lot of Russians in New York who will probably be at the card. Mm-hmm. So I think you could build around it. But anyway, that's what they're doing. they're probably going to come strong with a lot of talent, but you don't want to also put the whole roster out there because then the events that come afterwards suffer. Today we have two guests, Eric Del Fiero, head coach at Alliance MMA in San Diego. He's also a promoter for what used to be Total Combat down in San Diego. And now he's brought back as Alliance MMA, the promotion under Alliance MMA, the umbrella that covers Cage Fury Fighting Championships and some other local promotions scattered throughout the Midwest. There was an announcement not too long ago. But in this case, that's the confusing thing for me, is it's CFFC 64 that's headed to San Diego this Saturday. And Burt Watson's already in town because, as you know, he's the coordinator for CFFC. So he's coordinating this event. Regardless, we'll talk to him. Miles Hunsinger's on the card, goes.
Yeah.
Danny Davis Jr.'s on the
card. Training hard, both those guys.
Exactly. So a couple local guys here from Las Vegas. Christian Aguilera, who I've seen, and well, so have you.
Bama.
Down in Bama. He's on the bill as well. So we'll talk to Eric about that. That's towards the end of the show. Both of the interviews are towards the end of the show. We'll also talk to Hakeem Dawodu, who got a win over Steven Seiler at World Series of Fighting 35. First part of the show is wide open. 866-522-2846. In fact, let's sneak a couple in right now. They're waiting. Brandon from Louisville will start things off. What's up, Brandon?
All right, boys. We're just going to get into this. We're going to go ahead and take care of it so I don't have to hear any more about it. The only time we speak of this, Bellator's doing another pay-per-view. Have they not learned from the mistakes of other promotions?
How many did they do the first time? Do you guys remember?
They've done one.
Right. Did it do at least 100?
One. Affliction did
two.
Mm-hmm.
Or no, wait. The third one didn't go off, right?
The third one did not go off.
Here's the thing, though, man. I mean, they have good fighters, good fights that I would be willing to pay for. Would you not pay for Fedor and Mitrione? See Vanderlei and Chael settle things? And then sprinkle in a couple interesting matchups? I would do it. The question is, though, once you do that, what's the rest of the year going to look like for you? You know, are you going to get these guys to rebound and put on good cards?
Well, here's the thing. If it doesn't have those three magic letters in front of it, you're not going to make any money. The UFC has got the name brand. Bellator does not yet. They'll get the hardcores, yeah. They won't get all of them. I'm probably not, unless they just load that thing up to the gill. I didn't get the last two UFC pay-per-views, and quite honestly, the last one was better than what they're showing. They've already got planned for this. I just don't understand it. They've got a system that works. I know everybody wants that pay-per-view money, but it's just been a boondoggle for everyone else who's tried it. WEC was a great card. That pay-per-view did not sell well, and that had the backing of the UFC. It just had the wrong three letters in front of it.
Well, from what I'm understanding, though, they do make some money. It's not like it's a complete flop. Money is made. It's just it's not going to be anything that registers like what the UFC makes. But like the number we threw around, what if they make $100,000? $100,000 at 60 a pop, what's that, $6 million? Half of it goes to the pay-per-view companies. That's $3 million, you know, to start. I don't know. I don't think they'd be doing it if they didn't think it at least could bring in some revenue towards the company.
It just concerns me. I don't think it's a good plan for them. More and more we're trying to tell these companies get away from the pay-per-view model, and Bellator's trying to get into it.
But Brandon, don't you have to try new things? I mean, a lot of people also want Bellator to try new things within their company, new ideas. So it's not like they're force-feeding you. It's not like they did it last year. I think it was like 2-3 years ago since the last time they would do it. You know what I mean? So there's a chance it might have a little success, make a little bit of revenue for them, like I said. And what they're doing now, I think they get 10 polls or close to 2 million by the time all the numbers come in. And the regular cards get close to 1 million by the time all the numbers come in. So that's not exactly killing it either. You know, I think they want to, you know, I think they're just looking for new ways to make money.
I mean, we're not saying it's going to be a slam dunk, but it'll at least be a layup, right, Chris?
I think so.
Explain to Brandon what a layup is.
This is about the time you wanted to exit?
You know what? I'll go ahead and take it. Let's go ahead and let's rain it down on me.
What happened? Hey, no, seriously. What did happen with the left-handed? Did you have to do a left-handed layup, or could you have just done a right-handed from that side?
I had to do right, left, and then a free throw. And I can't go left. My left hand is like a dead hand.
Now, did they? Could you have made it from the left hand? Did they mean? I don't think they'd be that technical on a contest, right? Where they say you got to use your left. I think what they meant was just make it from the left hand side of the backboard.
They were pretty specific.
So this makes more sense because I thought what happens to UNLV games is you do a layup,
a free throw, and a
three
pointer,
and then a three pointer. So I was thinking he must have been going up against Jordan on the other side because that guy finished fast. But it's a layup, and then a free throw.
Did you make the free throw? You hinted that you didn't.
Did you all see it miss?
The video cuts out right when you
It was a swish. What happened on the left-hand layup, though? Did you get shot when you went up? Because that's what it looked like, that someone shot you in the leg and you just let go of the hand. Let go of the ball. It was pretty funny. Good job, though. At least you had the balls to do it.
It just flipped. Well, you know, sweaty palms. You know, they talk about octagon jitters, but, you know, I'm playing on, you know, I'm shooting a layup and a free throw on the home court of my team. You know, that's, you know, I got 6,000-7,000 people. Got the Tennessee band heckling me. I mean, it was, there was some butterflies.
Thanks, brother, for the call. We got to move on. Vegas Ford is up next. What's up, Ford?
Hey, guys, what's going on? It's a great morning for comedy. Did you see that Dave Chappelle is back with a new comedy special?
No. Did not see that.
Well, I mean, that coupled with Bellator getting back into the pay-per-view business, I mean, shit, it's like the golden age of comedy right now.
You're not going to get it, huh?
Seriously. Come on. I don't even watch. Come on, man. It's really... The main event, I see why they did it, you know, for name recognition, but nobody cares about Chael anymore. Chael's been a joke for years and years. I mean, ever since he got squashed by Rashad Evans in, like, what is that, like 25, 30 seconds? It's just been garbage ever since then. Vanderlei hasn't fought in years. Fedor, nobody knows. The casual fans don't know who Fedor is. They're not going to pay for him. Nobody cares about Matt Mitrione. Lorenz Larkin and Ryan Bader, okay, it's a Fight Night Memphis main event. Nobody cares. This is going to flop. It's going to do terrible. But it'll be fun watching the ship go down, though.
All right. Well, I'm going to watch it. I'm not too thrilled. I'm not really thrilled about paying for anything, honestly, when it comes to it. But it is the job. We have to do it. And so far, at least, the two matchups they've thrown our way look pretty good. And if Davis and Bader land, then, I'm on my way, I guess. Like I said, I've always said I'm easy to please. For crying out loud, I bought Jermaine DiRandami and Holly Holm. So,
does it come down to what does the UFC have to offer that month?
And well, they have
$50 are going to go either that here was, or here, or are you getting them both?
Oh, yeah, yeah. Well, the UFC is going to do something on International Fight Week like 2 weeks later, and they're doing three fight cards. So strategically, I think that was smart of Bellator because I don't know that the UFC is still into counter programming, but they won't really have much going on. I don't think there's UFC even scheduled for that weekend.
Well, you mentioned what does the UFC have to offer that weekend. If they have the Bellator card to offer. It's all former UFC fighters. I mean, they finally signed enough cast-offs to actually put on a show. Now, for it to be in Madison Square Garden as well, I mean, do you guys think that sells well? I mean, at the gate?
Man, I don't know. I've been to Fedor events in Anaheim, and they both got close to a sellout, right, Goes? Affliction?
Yeah, it was packed in there.
Yeah, and I don't know how San Jose did recently. I don't know, you know, what the final gate was, but who knows? Maybe 10,000 is a solid number for them.
They'll need a lot of curtaining for the top, the upper deck there at the Garden. But anyways, where's Danny?
Danny's off today.
Wednesday through Friday.
Wednesday through Friday? Okay, gotcha. Well, I called your other producer, Jabroni, on Facebook, and I apologize for that. And he's a pretty good guy. So anyways,
all right,
you guys enjoy.
Take care.
Have a good day.
You too.
And we'll see you.
Let's go to Aaron in Minneapolis. What's up, Aaron?
Hey, what's up, guys? First off, Ford, it he brings up Dave Chappelle's back. Hopefully he's got new material. We know Ford doesn't. but I'll be checking that out. Brandon from Louisville, just so you know, Viacom has a lot of money. So, I mean, they probably could care less if it doesn't do what they want it to do. Oh, well, you know, I mean, like you said, even if they make a little money, it's worth a try. They have nothing to lose. They are not Affliction or these other companies that have a few investors. They're pretty big. So, and what we've seen with Spike, Bellator, they make money and they sell a lot on names. It doesn't have to be these, you know, up and coming stars. They make money off the guys that, you know, kind of flopped in the UFC, and that's kind of their fan base on Spike TV. So do it.
From what, you know, I mean? See, Rampage versus King Mo sold 100,000. Of course I'm going on Wikipedia. I that's the first thing that popped up, and I thought I heard that anyway. Almost 3 years ago. That card had Will Brooks and Michael Chandler, Quinton Jackson and Muhammad Lawal, Tito Ortiz and Alexander Shlemenko. So Blagoy Ivanov was on there as well with Alexander Volkov. Michael Page versus Ricky Rainey. Chet Congo was on there. Marcin Held. So they came pretty strong with that one. And I imagine that's what they'll do with the next one. So I think it's the right time to try something like that.
I think sometimes we overestimate what it takes for them to actually make money. I mean, Affliction, they paid a ton of money to fighters, you know, to come fight. Viacom, they have a lot of employees, so it's not like they have to go spend a ton of money for people to set this up. Moving on, the reason I called is because I saw, I posted a comment online about it too, Derek Lewis and Mark Hunt fighting. And, you know, we always see these MMA white knights who get so angry about matchups that are, you know, made in, you know, because of promotion, because of making money, not because of the sport. But I think that people, those same people should be pretty upset that Mark Hunt is able to go fight because he just got knocked out. You know, if you want this to be a sport, then he should not be fighting. He shouldn't be going back into training. He shouldn't be fighting in 3 months at the risk of getting injured. This is about making money right here. They've got a show out in New Zealand. And I could care less. I'm just saying those same people must be pretty upset, and I'll take it off air.
See, Aaron, I thought the same thing. I know he's there because that's where he stay at. That's his neck of the woods.
Yeah.
But that was a pretty brutal KO.
I mean, he went
versus
out.
Alistair Overeem, and it does appear to be too soon. Lose a decision. All right, he was exhausted. His body wear and tear. Blah blah blah. Even if there was some punches that took their toll, but it wasn't a clean KO like that one. Mm-hmm. You know, I just think sometimes if the timing lines up, great, you're in luck. But if it doesn't, God, wow. Now, granted, he's an adult, and he's also accepted it. They offered it, but he accepted it. So a lot of it rests basically on Mark Hunt. Maybe we should say, well, what about his team, or what about anybody else? Why aren't they standing in the way? Yeah, you're right. Those are great questions. But part of that pie, I think, also lies on the UFC, man. I don't know. That's just too soon, right?
Definitely too soon. I mean, it's too soon. Because he's got to get back into training.
Right. You
see what I'm saying? Like, it's not a – he didn't really have time to relax and heal and just – I don't know. And then you got Derek Lewis who
– That I can almost get by, though. It's just the knockout.
Yeah, yeah. But, I mean, even Derek Lewis said, like, I want to take time. And now he's right back in there.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know. It just – it seems unnecessary.
I agree. That one I didn't like. I agree with Aaron. I thought about that. Let's take a quick break. When we come back, we'll take some more calls. Todd from Indiana is already on hold. The queue is wide open, 866-522-2846. You're listening to MMA Junkie Radio on Sirius XM, Rush 93.
They were forged from the same ball sack, but act as though they've never met. They are the brothers Garcia, Gorgeous George, and Goes.
All right, we're taking calls here in this first hour of the Tuesday, March 21st MMA Junkie Radio Show. Let's call it like 2410. We're somewhere in that range, closing in on 2,500 shows this summer. Also, our 10-year anniversary is coming up on April 11th. I'm letting you know, that way there's adequate time to ship gifts and stuff.
Yeah.
You know, overseas sometimes we takes like 2-3 hours. Or, sorry, 2-3 weeks. So, you know, has to go through customs and all that.
People still signing on for this thing.
For what?
The Junkie Gathering.
Really?
I just got a message from someone this morning that's made a few that thinks he may be able to pull it off now.
Didn't you say you had 3 to announce? Or did you ever get to that?
One of them fell off.
Okay.
And the other two are still kind of working on it.
All right.
But I think they're going to be good to go soon.
The Junkie Gathering is a ton of fun, and it happens May 23rd through the 27th. Stuff happening a couple days before, stuff happening a couple days after, but the bulk of it is the 23rd through the 27th. We'll be doing a bunch of activities here in the Mandalay Bay casino, where our home base is, our studio. And most of them, if not all of them, involve MMA fighters and notables. And it's just basically, it's like summer camp, right?
Pretty much like fantasy camp, right?
Fantasy camp. We're doing a lot of stuff with fighters, with MMA notables. A lot of it is activities, and a lot of it is just chilling and hanging out and partying. No better place to do that here in Las Vegas. You have to get here on your own. So check airfare. It always goes up with every day that passes. You can always drive here if you're close enough. And where to stay, well, that's up to you. But we are in Mandalay Bay, so if money isn't too tight, I recommend Mandalay Bay or the Delano. There's two towers here. Of course, Luxor is attached to us, so you're not exposed to the summer heat. You just walk through the tunnel, and you're here. They're a little bit cheaper in price. And then there's also Excalibur that's attached to the Luxor. Right across the street from Excalibur, in one direction is the Tropicana, and then another direction is the New York, New York. Now, the New York, New York is an MGM property like Mandalay Bay. Speaking of MGM, that's catty corner to Excalibur. So they're all walking distance, and I promote that because not just because they're an MGM property, but I'm telling you, man, we do our fair share of drinking. Sometimes you just want to get out of here and know that you can walk to your room in about 15 minutes, and all those hotels are close enough. You stay at downtown or way down on the other end of the strip. Those not Uber rides, they add up. Taxis, they add up. Or the long walks just suck balls, man.
Forget something in your room.
Yeah.
It's right there. You can go back, get it.
Get your charger.
Get a little napping.
Exactly. Break away. Hey, man, I hit a wall. I'm going to break away for 2 hours. Cool. All right. See you in, you know, 2.5. 15 to get there. Couple to sleep. 15 to get back. But you start doing stuff all over this place, and it's just I don't know. I feel like you break away a little bit. So there should be something within your price range at all of those. And I'm not hating on Tropicana. It's just not MGM Resorts. But it's nice. I've been there. We just went there for the lion fight. Yeah, it's chill. It's chill. All right. Let's take some more calls. Todd from Indiana, you're up next. Oh, number to call in, 866-522-2846. You just heard the first two callers, for crying out loud. The bar hasn't been raised. So if it's your first time and you're nervous, or you've done this before and you felt like you suck, you're fitting right at home. Let's go to Todd in Indiana. What's up, Todd? Take it up a notch.
What's going on, gentlemen?
Thank you
very much for taking my call.
How are you doing?
Two things. I'm really confused about Bellator doing a pay-per-view card. I thought when Coker took over Bellator, he said that, you know, Viacom's major thing was to increase television ratings. I don't get why you wouldn't build a super card and charge advertisers more. I mean, if we're talking $3 million, do commercial spots for $100,000 a pop for minute, you know, 1 minute spots, and you can make that money on a 3 hour card on Spike and really, you know, pump your programming and everything through that. So I was just a little confused by that.
It's hard to hate on that. You're making excellent points, and I absolutely see where you're going with it. I mean, it really is hard to hate on that idea. throughout the year, it'll just be one great card after another. That's the part that scares me. Are they going to blow their wad here? Like, are we going to get just crappy cards after this?
Well, I mentioned 100,000 because that's what they made for Rampage versus Chemo. What if they make 200,000, which would still not be an impressive number according to boxing and MMA. Sorry, boxing and UFC numbers, but it would still be extremely great revenue for their company. I don't know. I think they have trends and analytics that tell them, look, this is what we think we can score. New York is going to be a good gate for them. So all they can do is try. And as long as you don't completely, you know, use up the whole roster and you don't mess up what you got going on throughout the year, I'm all for trying.
Yeah, and I wouldn't hold anything against them. I mean, they're in business to make money, obviously. And if, you know, you can make money, and I'm sure Viacom has a pay-per-view partner that maybe they don't have to do that 50-50 split with. Maybe they can do 60-40 or something. That would save them, you know, that would help make a lot of the money.
This is true.
I was confused when I read that. I'm like, man, you know, you're trying to build a TV product and, you know, separate yourself from the UFC a little bit. You're kind of going to go down their same path. The other thing, I worry about Mark Hunt taking that fight. It does seem like he's been hit a lot and by a lot of guys that hit really hard recently. Just seems like another hard hitter that's going to swing at his head for 25 minutes.
Right, because I clearly remember Mark Hunt not fighting on every card that had to do with New Zealand or Australia. Sometimes the timing works, and if it does, awesome. And if it doesn't, you know, I just think the UFC's a juggernaut, man. They can move on. They can insert other fighters that might be willing to go in there and carry that card. But, that was a brutal knockout. I was there in person for that one. I want to see this guy collect a few more paychecks. And the little I know about it is successive camps and, you know, possible concussions. That can really be traumatizing going forward. I think you really need to rest at least a minimum of 6 months before you get back in there. And these heavyweights, that's exactly what they're doing. They're trying to knock each other's block off. It's not like Mark Hunt is preparing for leg locks or anything like this. I mean, we know exactly what's headed his way.
Well, you don't have to look past guys like Chuck. I mean, Chuck took too many shots to the head, and they knocked his career short. You know, I just don't want to see the same thing happen to Mark Hunt. I like watching him fight, and don't want to see him get beat up too bad too often.
Yeah, I mean, couldn't they rebook it for just later in the year?
But yeah, that would be an awesome September fight, you know?
I mean, it's a great fight. It's right. A fight that every time one of these two guys fights, they go, who's next for him? We always put those two together, right?
Lewis wanted additional time off. Hunt could use the time off. So, yeah, September, October. I mean, I'm sure the arena's got some sort of an opening where they can go, let's just run it then. Mm-hmm. Hey, maybe we lost a deposit, or maybe there was some pre-hype already, some marketing, some PR. Okay, we take a hit there, but let's regroup. Because Whitaker's also fighting Jacare here in about 2 weeks. Imagine him is in the co-main event slot.
Yeah,
you know what I mean. I think he could really do a good job there. That's what I would do.
Yeah.
All right.
Well, that's all I had, guys.
Thanks,
Todd.
All right. See ya.
Yep.
I mean, I know TV's complicated, and maybe reserving an arena is more difficult than I think, or maybe once you make your commitment to your broadcast partners, you have to run with it. But I, you know, this is us just standing from the outside trying to figure things out. They've canceled cards before. Shit, I think LA took the brunt of two of them, right?
Mm-hmm.
It just recently happened with Anaheim.
LA's had bad luck.
And they had the Jose Aldo, Chad Mendes. I think it would have been their second edition, or maybe the first one in LA. And wasn't there one? And then the Dan Henderson one here. So we've been near the proximity of where it's happened. I don't know. All right. Muna from San Francisco. What's up, Muna?
Hey, how's it going, gentlemen?
Good.
Hello,
and you?
Muna.
Doing well. I'll be quick. One, shout out to the Dallas, Oklahoma folks in town. Not sure why they are there in Vegas, but shout out to them, and glad they came to the show. Two more questions.
In case you didn't know, because Aaron was really tight-lipped about this, he proposed on Saturday.
Get out.
Yeah, Aaron from Texas.
Oh, man.
So that was one thing.
Oh, it happened in Vegas.
Uh-huh.
Nice.
It happened on the plane. And then Billy and Aaron are also in town for... It did, yeah. Baron,
I don't know about that.
Aaron and Billy also are here in town for a conference they work for Samsung. You know, I thought Billy was still with Verizon. He left there 4 years ago. Shows you how behind the times I am.
And this
I'm
morning,
the type of guy that would walk up to Manny at Gambrian and go, how's the shoulder? but, yeah, he they work for Samsung now, and so there's a convention here. So aside from that, they also had business to tend to.
And there was
nice. Yeah,
Dwayne and Regina from Oklahoma.
They're here?
Yeah, they stopped mm-hmm. here this morning.
Okay.
They'll be back a little later.
Yeah. Now,
cool.
I hope they're careful, though. You know, some of those phones, they tend to explode. So hopefully they have the bomb squad there in case something like that goes down. I think for anyone to get hurt.
So, all right. Well, hopefully it doesn't get too explosive. Ghost, quick question for the Junkie Gathering. Who's your quarterback? Because, I mean, that's really the most important position when you guys play flag football. Have you guys figured that out yet?
We have two. We have Rob Cardenas, and we have Sportsbook
Matt. Ooh.
What about Brett Okamoto? Did he say he was a quarterback, too, or no?
I think he's got hands.
Oh, he's got hands. Okay. Yeah. And then what about Michael Sanchez? I thought he said he played QB as well.
Did he?
Yeah.
Okay.
You might have to have some tryouts, right?
Yeah, we might have to do
that. yeah, definitely the tryouts, Coach. You need to keep the quarterback's key. And last question, since you guys are from the OC, all the cards have been kind of figured out in terms of the pay-per-views, except for that Anaheim card. And just kind of looking at the champions, you usually need a big draw, especially with Ronda retired. So who do you guys hope headlines that Anaheim card? And I'll take it off there.
All right, see you, Muna.
Thank
well, that sounds like Bisping GSP territory because that's what Dana said, for one. And
he's a local guy.
Bisping's a local guy. He's an Anaheim Hills guy, I believe, is where he lives now. And I think they'll just want to come back with, you know, a strong card after canceling the first time, therefore, and not being back there in such a long time. That I think GSP is a name that would make sense. Now, that said, there's just a couple of those guys that if you're going to keep them out of their hometown, like GSP Montreal, they usually also bring them to Vegas. So it could be that they're part of International Fight Week, and if that rules them out, then I guess would be who would be your next guess.
It's hard to guess. You got to let all that play out, right? That's a lot of fighters.
You got to let Stipe and JDS play out, DC and Johnson. So let's say one possibility might be DC Johnson winner versus John Jones, right? The other thing would be,
I mean, the guy that they love fighting down there in Southern California, he's just not healthy right now, but we really don't know to what extent. Cain Velasquez is a big draw out there. They always try and get him on those cards.
That's a good point. But I think that you want to come with a world title.
Oh, the headline.
Yeah. Oh, meaning he would get the next shot?
No. What I mean is just being on that card, a big presence.
Yeah.
You know, you look at your Cub Swansons, your Cain Velasquez.
Yeah, your Rodriguez.
Ooh, George. That's a good one.
Hmm.
That's a solid one.
The winner of Holloway and Aldo. Aldo doesn't fight frequently. That'd be a quick turnaround. Be about less than 2 months. So that might not work. That rules them out. Joanna and
Jessica.
Joanna and Jessica, that's in May. That's also bordering on a quick turnaround. Who are we leaving out here? Oh, Tyron. Tyron Woodley. Tyron versus Maya? I don't know.
He doesn't really have SoCal written all over it.
He doesn't, yeah. Tyron versus Maya. Is that who's next for him? Is that who's next for him?
Yeah. I mean, yeah. Well, no. We really don't know, right?
Yeah. You're right. We don't. All right. Let's take a quick break. You're listening to MMA Junkie Radio on SiriusXM Rush 93. When we come back, we'll try and figure out who's that headliner for July 29th in Anaheim, California. UFC, let's see here. What are they going to be at that point?
211's next.
212. I think they labeled it 214. Doesn't matter. Whatever the number is, it's the 29th of July in Anaheim, California. And we're trying to figure out what the main event might be. So let us figure that out. We'll be right back.
Tell your boss to reschedule that meeting. Call your wife and tell her lunch is off. It's time for more MMA Junkie Radio with Gorgeous George and Goes.
This is the way the year plans out. UFC 210 has the light heavyweights Cormier and Johnson. UFC on Fox 24 has Johnson versus Hayes. Then we have two title fights at UFC 211, Miocic and Dos Santos, that's the heavyweights, and Joanna Jędrzejczyk versus Jessica Andrade. So through May, that's four titles. We just had Tyron and Woodley. 212 has Aldo and Holloway on June 3rd. But what we're trying to guess is who might be the headliner for UFC 214 at the Honda Center in Anaheim, California on July 29th. Now, I'm just going to use the three-month mark. Let's say whoever it is, they're healthy. They got 3 months to prepare from when their fight ended. So 1 month to kind of decompress, recover, and then the two-month camp. Right. That would rule out Holloway and Aldo, in my opinion. June 3rd to July 29th? I mean, it's been done before. Ronda did it, but I'm sure a few others have done it. But that's just, I don't know.
If you owe Anaheim one, I owe you one. If you're in that scenario. Mm-hmm. You do not want Jose Aldo come back with
true.
That, right?
Yeah, if Holloway wins it and he does something quick like what Connor did, then perhaps he'll say, let's run it, you know? It's close to Hawaii. He may do it. But that would be extreme, you know, the extreme exception there. Now, who hasn't been booked is, what does that leave us? I think Garbrandt and TJ will be part of those three shows in July.
Correct.
Because one of them's the pay-per-view, one of them's the finale, and the other one's just a fight night, right? All right. So that leaves them out. The women's bantamweight. Recently, we had Amanda tell Valentina June 3rd, and Valentina said, no, I'm ready in July. We tried to do it in April. You weren't ready. I'm doing me. So July could qualify, but I could see that being part of those 3 days as well because it could fill in for one of those – you know, the three that we just said, mm-hmm. which is also a GSP Bisping, you know. Since Woodley just happened, I could see him heading towards Anaheim, but good point. It doesn't have that feel to it.
It just doesn't.
So if he fights Maya doesn't have that feel to it either with L.A., you know what I mean? If it was, let's say Ferguson was a welterweight, then we'd go, oh, yeah, that makes sense.
Yeah.
But he's not. He's a lightweight. So, and Connor's just off to the side. So could that be Ferguson Habib in, you know, the interim if they run it back?
It wouldn't be bad.
Okay. It could be Woodley, but it does, like we said, it doesn't seem to fit. And then
you absolutely
going back 3 months from July is, yeah, I think so.
Because Yair makes a lot of sense.
May 29th, April 29th. All those others would qualify. The winner of Johnson Cormier, the winner of Hayes and Johnson.
When do Edgar and Yair fight?
Miocic Dos Santos and Joanna Andrade, they wouldn't qualify just because of the 3 months. But it's not to say they can't turn it around. Excuse me?
Yair's next fight. When is that?
And by the way, none of those have an L.A. feel to it either. Dos Santos, Stipe, Joanna, Andrade. Cormier and Johnson, a little bit because Johnson used to live on the West Coast, but he doesn't. But Cormier does. He could drop down. And he's an L.A. guy through Fox. And Johnson versus Hayes. I mean, Hayes is now in San Diego, but that's not a seller. In fact, if Hayes beat Johnson, he would just be a co-main. Honestly, he couldn't even be the main event. So through process of elimination, we're running out here. I think you might see Tyron Woodley and somebody. I mean, it'll be a stacked card. I think they can really, really, you know, jack it up a little bit. Plus, they have the 45ers. Jermaine versus Cyborg. Will she be ready by then?
She's local.
She's local. So there's some names for you. That was a great question. Hal from Chicago will start things off in the next hour because we only have like about a minute left.
We don't want to disrespect you.
Before the first hour is over. You're listening to MMA Junkie Radio on Sirius XM Rush 93. So we have to do a commercial and then a sports update, and then we'll come back and open up with some calls. Now, also coming at you in the second hour will be Hakeem Dawodu, who just got a win at World Series of Fighting 35. He is 7-0 with 6 KOs. His last fight was his first decision win. It was over UFC veteran Steven Seiler. We'll also talk to Eric Del Fierro, the head coach at Alliance MMA in San Diego, and also the promoter for this weekend's card out in San Diego, CFFC 64, which still seems bizarre to me. I don't know if it's just their license, their banner. Why would he be the promoter? He has his own thing. You know what I mean? That's the trip that I'm going through with this Alliance MMA. We'll have him sorted out. But I know Burr Watson's out there, and I know there's some decent quality fighters that are fighting on the fight card. So if you want to check it out down in San Diego, CFFC 64 on Saturday. We'll talk more about that in that second hour. So Salmon goes. Go light up the restroom or whatever you do during these next 4.5 minutes. Or if not, I'll go do it. We'll be right back after this break.
Viva Las Vegas with your neon flashing and your one-armed bandits crashing.
idiot. Yeah, you. Can you please tap that rather large fellow on the shoulder and tell him it's time for more MMA Junkie Radio with Gorgeous George and Goes? Thank you.
We're going to start things off with Beachy Howe from Chicago. Been waiting the longest. It's 866-522-2846 if you want to follow him. What's on his mind? What's up, Hal? How you doing?
What about Verdum? What's he got going?
Well, there's plenty of names that we could fill in. You're right, L.A. based, perfect. But we were starting off with just who can defend, and so that ruled Verdum out.
All right. Well, then I think probably Demetrius versus Benavidez. You know.
This is a pay-per-view, and Demetrius hasn't been on many pay-per-views like that. If he is, he's in a supporting role as a co-main. So I like it. I mean, I'm a fan of Benavidez. I want him to get that third shot. I don't think Benavidez wants to wait that long, though. That's one thing he's been very clear about on our show. Or in times we've, run into him in passing, he just wants to fight. That doesn't mean he can't be on the card, but I think I'm really liking the Cyborg angle. The Bisping angle. The question is Cyborg the lead goes? Could she carry it? Like that? Or
I think in Anaheim,
or you think is that where you bring in a little bit more backup? Because we had the Lilith affair one time. Remember when Ronda was a headliner? I think it was Raquel and Holly. Mm-hmm. And you know who fell off that card? Mir Silva, Antonio, Bigfoot, Weidman, Machida. I think fell off that card. It was one other big fight, dude. I think it may have been the first Romero Jaca. It fell off, and Ronda still pulled in 600 pay-per-views. It was amazing.
My wishful thinking would be...
Oh. It may have been, yeah.
My wishful thinking would be, Nate or Nick Diaz comes back and fights Robbie Lawler.
Now, that can do it, yeah. I mean, there's a few guys that can do it outside of a title fight, and you just named them right there.
But, to play devil's advocate, whoever came up with that question, interesting question, but come on. I mean, come on. Like Rick Buda would say, come on. Predicting a UFC card months from now is like trying to think of what the Chicago weather is going to be like this weekend. You're just throwing darts, But but that would be awesome if Lawler fought a Diaz in SoCal. I wanted to talk a little bit more about Marlon Chito Vera and give him his due credit. Yeah, that's what I think is missing now is the story of the fighters. This guy, for a lot of people who didn't watch Tough Latin America, which is probably 95% of MMA fans, if you remember, Marla has a daughter, and she has a rare neurologic syndrome where she can't smile. You remember that?
Yes.
Yeah, she literally cannot smile. So you can imagine how devastating that could be. And so he needed money. He went on Tough partly to become a UFC fighter, but also to pay for his daughter's surgery, which I think she had already, but he's in debt to pay that off. He even started a GoFundMe last year, and Fabricio Verdum and Brunson and Beck Rawling, some people donated. This is the American dream right here. This is it. This kid, 16, decides to be an MMA fighter, and he watched UFC, his favorite fighter is GSP, and he goes after a dream in Ecuador, man. You know what the odds are? It's kind of like Amanda Nunez. Coming from a fella, he's a kid from Ecuador, man. There's nothing there. And he made it, and he's not just content with making it. The guy realizes, I need to train. And so he moves to San Diego, and now he's with Timo Yama. We got something for your mama. That's what Rampage Jackson said one time in a Pride interview with Moro. He was with Timo Yama back in the day.
Right.
And look at him now, man. He's taking fights on short notice. I mean, yeah, he was getting worked by Pickett, but 9 days notice. Mm-hmm. This kid's amazing, and he learned English. Look at his English. It's when he was on the show, he didn't speak English, or very little. So this guy's a motivated individual, man. Respect for him.
That is pretty interesting the way you said it.
But he just got lost in the shuffle.
The problem is they all get lost in the shuffle, and it takes a while to come out of that shuffle and for us to go, wait a minute, there's going to be a few fights where no one's questioning that. We already know the story, but it takes a while to get there, and that's why I think the fighter also has to assist in that. But definitely the promotion could do more of that. Now, on the flip side, I understand when the promotion goes, hey, man, we're trying to promote the promotion. We're giving these guys the platform to do their thing. We give them as much time as we can, 30 seconds after the fight, if they win. But it is expensive for them. And at the same time, they know that as soon as that fight's over, they just whisk him out and bring in two more. You know what I mean? And I've always said this. All those fighters could be on one plane, and I hate to use the example of the plane goes down, so I won't say it. The plane just happens to get lost in the Bermuda Triangle, lands on an island, no one can find them. The UFC would not miss a beat. You see all these guys that they're losing as it is, they just don't miss a beat. I think they are so focused on selling those three letters that the rest, they'll do it when they need to, when it behooves them, when they can sell more pay-per-views or get higher ratings on Fox. But other than that, they won't. So that's the formula. That means the fighters have to do it. And that means the managers have to get better to find the backing so that the fighters aren't out of pocket in doing that. But example, Champ Camp for Tyron Woodley, you know, he opens up his life really nice, but he's got the resources. Not all of them do. So again, hopefully managers can get better too. Agents can get better too. And you know, support the fighters a little bit in that regard because they have to do a lot of their own promotion.
Well, this guy just became one of my favorite fighters because after everything that I've told you, he had every right to grab that mic and relish in the victory and talk about, yay, this one goes out to Ecuador and my family and my daughter who's home and blah. He spends 80% of the time giving Pickett props because he knows exactly what moment that is.
Right.
He's only 24. You know, so props to that kid, man.
You know how I would have ended it, though?
How?
I said, adios, London, ahora me quito.
Nice.
That would have been good. Vamos, Kakura. All right, take care, guys.
All right, see ya. Great call by Hal.
Good
Things
job.
Got serious here on the MMA Junkie Radio Show. Let's go to Showtime in Tennessee. Hey, what's up, Showtime? It's yo time.
Hey, what's going on, fellas?
Not much, man.
Just left the Planet Fitness over here in Ontario, Cali, and got a little Mexican grill about to do lunch, man.
They have a Mexican grill in the Planet Fitness?
No, right next door.
Oh, okay. What are you going to smash, a burrito, enchilada, what?
Nah, I'm looking at this little grill, chicken and spinach. You know, I came and got off track out in Vegas, so I need to eat a little bit healthier now. So this little grill, chicken with spinach or something, I'm sitting looking at.
That's what's up.
Yeah. Man, I enjoyed you guys this past weekend, man. I just want you guys to know that I know I left out kind of devastated because I had duped and smashed about six. It ended up being about six different little parlays were hit. Everything hit but Duke.
Damn. Sorry to hear that.
I know. It's cool, man. It's cool. But I'm loving it, man. I'm nice show today. Just love you guys like family, man. I just want to come tell you guys that again, man. Every time I come out there and see you guys, man, it's just nothing but love, man. Nothing but love.
Thank you, Showtime. We enjoyed having you around, too.
Exactly. And back to that L.A. card, headlining. I was about to call in and say, Cyborg, somebody beat me to it. I think you got to put her on that card. I think that would be a good time to bring her back. I don't know. I mean, would she be able to fight for the title then? What's the issue with that? I don't. Jermaine or whatever.
We brought up Max Holloway and Jose Aldo, and we said, all right, what if Jose comes out of that? Is he really the guy that you want that entire card to depend on? Probably not. Now that I think about it, Cyborg might be in that same boat.
What boat?
Do you really want an entire card to depend on her?
Oh, yeah. Well, I think it'll be something like Dallas, honestly. I think a lot of the cards, they're going to try their hardest to stack them really nice. And this would be one of them. And I think they're smart enough to know that if it's a Jose or a Cyborg, that it should have backup on either another title fight or just featured fights like Poirier and Alvarez or what's the other one that was named recently on that card? Yair and Frankie. Mm-hmm. Yeah, in fact, that rules out Yair unless he comes out of that
It'd
pretty healthy.
It'd have to be fast. I mean, it's right there. It's mm-hmm. like at 2 months.
Right.
Yeah. Hey, let's not count the eggs before they hatch now with Yair and Frankie now.
True.
Well, I didn't name a winner, but I said maybe the winner could come out of that.
Yeah. Yeah.
If it's Yair, you know, there's a big Mexican population in California, so that might make sense. He may dig it. Who knows? There may be a Mexico card later on this year because much like London, Mexico comes strong. They usually sell out or do very well out there. And you want to definitely feature a guy like that.
Yeah, that's where a Kane, but then you guys, too, would you want to let it ride on a guy like Kane, putting him on that card? He kind of fit that same boat, as we, you know, that we're talking about with Jose and Cyborg. So, oof, you better put some for sure's on there that you know that's going to show up.
Fight. I hear you. I hear you, man. All right.
Hey, guys. Well,
good call.
Great show as usual, man. You guys have a good one.
Thank you. Take care.
All right. All right.
Showtime had 6 parlays that involved Duke?
Yeah, and they paid a good amount. It was funny because there was a time here where we all needed one team, mm-hmm. and Showtime needed the other. And he was really quiet.
Mm-hmm.
And then he told us once it went off, there was a way where we both won.
Mm-hmm.
And he goes, man, I was trying to stay quiet because I saw how into the game you guys were. And I didn't want to be that guy rooting against you because I had the other side.
Mm-hmm. Parlays are good, but not that many parlays.
Well, I think
the odds are definitely more on their side. So, like, once a week, like we do, you know, okay, who's fighting this weekend? Yeah, give me these 3, give me these 5, give me these 4, whatever, 6, 8, 9. That's fine. See you in a week. But that many parlays involving one team, well, you're almost better off going, just give me Duke on a straight play. Awesome. And you either go down with them or you win with them. But, you know, he's tying it into other stuff. And I know he's done well, so who am I to say? But I have a little experience when it comes to that. Hakeem Dawodu will be joining us soon. So will Eric Del Fiero. Tell you what, let's get another break out of the way. That way we're not running all over each other, tripping all over each other. And you're listening to MMA Junkie Radio on Sirius XM Rush 93. And what I'll do is I will get some iTunes comments ready because I want to read off a few of those. You guys have been really coming strong with those, and it helps us a lot on the iTunes side. I know lately I've been pounding the SoundCloud. Follow us there. YouTube, you know, check it out there. The website, we have all these tabs. Facebook, give us a like. Throw us some hearts. I know I'm a pain in the ass, but all this really, really, truly helps the show. We're here 2 hours a day, Monday through Friday, and it's a show that involves you all as listeners. So we give it right back to you. All right, we'll be right back after this break.
up, up, down, down, left, right, B-A, start. You told me that code would get rid of them. Yeah, well, they're still here. Okay, but now they know I tried to kill them. Hold on, Mom. Here are George and Goes.
All right. Time for some iTunes reviews. We have a few minutes here before Hakeem Dawodu calls in. Left off with some in August of 2016, so I'm running behind. You can rate us 1 to 5 stars on iTunes. We have 494 comments. It'd be nice to get to 500, and then, of course, from there, just continue on. The more we get, the merrier. No, seriously, iTunes has this bizarre algorithm that involves the activity on our show, so how frequent the frequency of our show. So how often do we do a show versus positive comments or just comments in general, and maybe length of show, maybe certain keywords. I don't know. I've done a lot of research on this, and there's not really a formula out there. But I know that we seem to get a little upkick on the rankings when we get these ratings. So if you do subscribe to us on iTunes, we would love a review. Of course, we'd love a 5-star review or a 4-star review, but what are you going to do? I know we're not everyone's cup of tea to the full, to the max, but maybe include in your review what we're doing wrong if we didn't gain all 5 stars. I'm going to read them all anyway, so blast away if that's your thing. But seriously, the support means a lot, so here's a few. This one comes from Elegant17 on October 5th, 2016. God, I hope I didn't read this last week, but this one says, one of my favorites, 5 stars. I can't always catch the show on Sirius, so I listen to it on here. Definitely one of the best. Made a loyal fan out of me, to be exact. Listen while I'm at work. Again, that's Elegant17 on October 5th, 2016. Thank you, sir. Or ma'am, sorry. This one comes from KM Chanson or KMC Chanson. No, KMC Hansen, probably. Daily Dose, 5 stars, October 18th, 2016. Okay, I had to rewrite this and submit a second time, so hopefully this isn't a duplicate. I'm a huge MMA fan, and I listen to MMA Junkie almost every day. The show definitely saves me from my 9-to-5 midday slump. I am in Virginia and on Eastern Time. George and Goes always keep me laughing and informed. One of the days I'll call in, but even without that, I feel like I am friends with G and G, as well as the personalities that call in. Thanks, guys. Well, hey, mission accomplished.
That's exactly what we want you to feel like.
Yeah. I mean, you cross through that door, we embrace or a fist bump or whatever, and you hang out. I'm telling you, man, there's no rush to get out. We hang out for a bit and shoot the shit. And as you've seen over the course of the past 10 years, many people have become great friends of ours. And a lot of junkies have become friends with each other. I was hearing a cool story the other day where Showtime from Tennessee, the truck driver, broke down in Dallas. Somewhere in Texas. I'm not sure if it was exactly in Dallas, but Billy McDonald helped him out with a part, took it to him, helped him get back on the road. That was pretty cool. Yeah. Chili Billy McDonald is here with Aaron from Texas. They met through the show as well, and now they work together.
Mm-hmm.
So that's awesome, man. Thank you, KMC Hansen. I think that's what it is for that review. We'll do one more. This one's only 4 stars. It's from MMA Fanatic, new listener. November 20th, 2016. Love the show. The format isn't what I'm used to, and there are lulls in the action every once in a while. But all in all, entertaining listen. Keep up the good work. Thank you, MMA Fanatic. Appreciate you. I guess I'll keep going as we wait for Hakeem Dawodu. On January 27th, 2017, so now we're getting closer to real time. At least we're out of last year. This one says, consistently excellent for a long time, 5 stars. These guys have been doing it for so well for so long. They know everybody in the game, and they are lifers to the sport. Listen to a handful of their shows, and you'll feel like a member of the family. Thank you so much, the podcast aficionado, on January 27th, 2017. Should I keep going, guys, or is there any news you want to discuss?
Well, there is one thing that we want to do.
Okay.
We want to do it next week. You?
Me?
Yeah, you. Versus me, versus Dan Tom, in the greatest music videos of all time. 10 rounds. Each one submits one each round. We take turns being the first guy.
And then we all look at each other. Oh, we have a judge?
Matt Erickson. He can cover.
That would be fun.
You see what I'm saying? So
we're outside the box.
You go, this is mine. And then we, obviously, we're in a better position because we can counter what you're doing. Mm-hmm. Then the next time, I go first. And then you guys can counter what I'm doing.
And we're outside the box. You know, we do MMA most of the time. Hell, we even tied in Dan Bilzerian, the king of Instagram, who made an in-studio visit last Friday. He trains. The possibility of a fight came out. But he also talked about his adventures, and I thought it was entertaining, man. I had a good time. Hopefully the listeners did too.
He was fun, yeah. I still get I got a couple comments about that last night.
Did you really?
Yeah.
All right.
Good stories.
Sam, how are we looking on our guest?
Hakeem is good to go.
He's good to go. All right. Let's talk to Hakeem Dawodu. Mean Hakeem Dawodu. 25 years of age. Fights in the featherweight division. I get confused, guys, because boxing, the welterweights are 147. So I see the 145, and I actually think that first. But Hakeem is coming off a win at World Series of Fighting 35, even off versus Jordan. It just took place this past Saturday. He defeated UFC veteran Steven Seiler. What's up, Mean Hakeem? How you doing?
Good, man. Just on break right now, just chilling, you know, about to make some lunch and, you know, eat while I can before I have to start, you know, watching what I eat again, you know.
Now, why'd you got to do that to my man, Steven Seiler? I've always been a fan of Steven Seiler, and I didn't know too much about you. So going in, I'm going to confess right now, I was rooting for Steven Seiler, but you went in there and you did work. So my hat's off, and I'm a fan of yours now.
You know, and thank you about that. I really appreciate that. To be honest with me, I think I underestimated Steven Seiler. I thought I was going to go knock him out. Usually I don't like taking a fight on 18 days notice, but I took the fight, and he actually he was a lot tougher than I thought he was going to be. He did a good job, but, you know, I needed a fight, and I just trying to stay consistent.
Yeah, no doubt.
I'm sorry I did your boy like that, but, you know, I can't let that all go. So.
I hear you, man. It's business. You know what I'm saying? Hey, first of all, let's rewind now. What's for lunch, by the way? What are you having for lunch? It has to be something pretty simple and healthy, you said, right? Usually fighters are splurging after a fight, but you got to keep it nice and tight. So what's for lunch?
Well, no, I can actually eat a little bit. For lunch, I got me some pasta from the Italian market, and I'm going to buy me some jumbo shrimp fried up and just have me a nice little feast.
Damn.
That does sound pretty good. He hit one out of the park there.
Yeah.
Now I'm hungry.
You know, I'm back already training. You know, I just came from the gym today, lifted some weights. You know, I'm going to take this week easy, and then I'll be back training hardcore. You know what I mean?
I wanted to ask you, you said you were on break, so I wasn't sure if maybe you had a full-time job and you were on break from that. You're just on break from training, so you are a full-time fighter?
I fight full-time, but I also teach kickboxing. And boxing as well. I have a lot of private lessons, and I teach classes over at Mike Miles Muay Thai Kickboxing. Mm-hmm.
Is there a spike in personal training when you do add another number, you know, to that win column? Like, man, this guy knows what's up. I want to get some one-on-one time with him.
For sure, there's always that spike after fights. But I just lately, you know, besides being a fighter, I'm known as a really good pad holder, really good stand-up coach. So a lot of guys have been coming to me regardless. I've been getting really popular that way just from doing private lessons and teaching guys the way I fight. So regardless of, you know, I'm a good coach and I'm also good at fighting, two separate things that are independent.
Tell me a little bit about your team, your coaches, your management. Who helps keep you in line and prepares you for every one of your fights?
So I do my Muay Thai at Mike Miles Muay Thai Kickboxing. That's where I started. That's the first gym I started fighting out of. I do my MMA, and also I do my MMA and mixed martial arts, jiu-jitsu, and my wrestling at Champions Creed with my coach, Brian Bird. Mm-hmm. I do my boxing over at Teal Fista Boxing with my coach, Eric De Guzman. We work on the hands and also game planning and stuff like that. And I do my strength and conditioning over at the Athletes Factory. And besides that, I'll kind of just, you know, pop around gym to gym and just trying to find myself sparring partners when I'm in the city. Mm-hmm. I work with, you know, some of the other guys around the city, Jesse Arnett and all those other guys that are, you know, coming up too.
Now, we know you have a decorated striking background. Tell us a little bit about the ground game, jiu-jitsu, wrestling, how much work goes into shoring up that part of the game.
you know, honestly, I grapple just as much as I strike now. Like, you know what I mean? Grappling, it's just part of the game. You know what I mean? A lot of people, for some reason, think I'm not grappling. I don't know what they, I don't know what they're thinking, but a lot of people think I'm not grappling. But it's just I prefer to, you know, put on good fights and get that knockout. That's what the fans like, and that's what I like to do. That's how I prefer to fight. But, you know, the grappling aspect, I'm rolling every day. I'm wrestling every day, so I'm never lacking on that. That's been a part of my training for a while. And my last fight, I got to show it, and you could see I'm no slouch on the ground. I just prefer to keep it standing so I can put you out.
Mm-hmm. Do you love it, or do you just put up with it? Meaning the training of the wrestling and jiu-jitsu?
At first, I hated it. You know what I mean? I was a striking guy. I was like, I hate this. You know, I hate grappling.
Right.
These guys' breath stink. You know what I mean? Like, it was just over time. You know what I mean? This guy's got, you know, you got those guys, knee open, big hairy chest in your face. But, you know, just like anything, I got used to it. And I love it now. It's part of training. I'm a mixed martial artist now, the number one Canadian. It's just part of training. I like it almost as much as I like striking.
Me and Hakeem Dawodu, our guest here on MMA Junkie Radio. He's coming off a win at World Series of Fighting 35. Ivanov versus Jordan. He defeated UFC veteran Steven Seiler. Goes, what do you have for me and Hakeem?
Hakeem, you said you normally don't like to take fights on short notice. Why did you do it this time?
Because I really needed a fight. I was begging for a fight, and, you know, it was ridiculous. Like, everybody, no Canadians even fight me, you know what I mean? No Canadians would fight me. I was trying to even get some local shows. No Canadian would fight me. I don't care what they say. And I'm trying to stay busy. I want to stay busy. You know, I come from a kickboxing background, and I like to, you know, have more than at least four fights a year.
Do you know how many you'll have this year? Did you have an opportunity to talk to the brass after the card? Did they tell you when they see yourself getting back in there?
They see me getting back in. Ray was telling me around June. And it's my last fight on the contract for WSOF. So me and my manager are just going to sit down and see what's best for me next and, you know, make a wise choice.
You talked about keeping that O, and if you look up and down your record, it's pretty impressive, all the stoppages you have. The one thing that stands out is the draw. Does that still bother you to this day?
No. The draw, you know, bothered me, but, you know, when I got the rematch with him, I put him away in the second round with a body shot and I dropped him. So I kind of feel like I'm past that. That rematch, I think I'm past that draw. I redeemed myself and in a good way. You know, it didn't go to decision. It was a very clear win. So I'm kind of past that draw.
Hakeem, did you say you're a free agent now or you have another fight left?
I have one more fight coming up in June and then I'd be a free agent.
Oh, interesting. All right. What do you want to do? Do you want to fight for a title before you even get yourself in that position, or you just want to get the fight done and then deal with what you're going to do, whether it's stay with WSOF and fight for a title or go to another promotion?
You know, if I fight for the title and I plan on winning the title, you know, that'd be another year I'd have to stay with WSOF. So, like I said, me and my management, we're going to have to look into that and see what's the best choice for me, or bang this last fight out on my contract. So we'll be contacting, you know, WSOF, and I'm sure we'll have a good plan and see what's next for me.
Mm-hmm. Did you?
You know, whatever the best option, I'm willing to take.
Did you happen to see Harrison and Palmer, and what did you think of that fight?
I thought, you know, I thought Palmer was going to win, and it was very odd the way he was moving and wasn't striking. But then I later found out, supposedly he broke his hand or something like that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think I did hear that as well. Yeah, I mean, two judges had it 2-2 going into the fifth, so it definitely was up for grabs in the fifth. But Harrison,
really, I had Andre Harrison winning, you know, mostly the whole fight. I actually, the first round Lance did all right, but after that, you know, I could definitely tell something was off. I was like, why can't he throw anything? And Harrison hurt him multiple times, so I didn't think it was really close.
Mm-hmm. Tell me a little bit more about you. Were you born in Calgary, Alberta, Canada, or did you move to Calgary, Alberta, Canada?
No, I was born here, born and raised. You know what I mean? I lived here my whole life.
Okay.
I'm really everybody. You know, I know everybody in the city. So born and raised here, I got a lot of people cheering for me, a lot of people supporting me here.
Mm-hmm. You know, I'm looking at your record through Sure Dog, and I love your Muay Thai shorts. You know, Mean Hakeem, it just kind of stands out. It looks really, really cool. It looks like you, like, fighting isn't just a job. It's something you enjoy, and anything that comes with it, you know, like I'm so used to seeing the UFC guys just wear a Reebok that when I watch the other promotions, now I'm watching the gear a little bit more, you know what I mean? Just to see, like, what you rep, what you're all about. So it's kind of cool to see that.
Yeah, you know, I love the Muay Thai shorts, you know what I mean? Like, I think if I can, I'd always like to wear Muay Thai shorts throughout my whole career. Black and gold are just, like, my favorite colors. I feel like those are the colors that represent me. So I usually always like to stay with the black and gold Mean Hakeem shorts. Mm-hmm. So, yeah, you know, I enjoy fighting. You know, I enjoy the style of it. I'm a big fight fan. I love watching fights. I love, you know, I love it all. I'm generally, you know, a real fighter. Mm-hmm.
And going forward with the one fight left, I know you don't want to reveal your hand, but I got to ask, is your ultimate goal to get into the UFC, you know, where a lot of the best 45ers reside and test your skills against them? Are you more driven by who can maybe feature you and promote you and you know, or pay you the most? Like, I guess, how will you sift through all the different offers and opportunities?
I guess we're at, you know, I'm at the point where I want to be in the league that's going to give me, you know, don't get me wrong, I like, you know, whoever's going to be able to pay me most, but for me, I want to get in the league where I'm going to be able to get the most respect and most definitely be the best 145 or so. And I mean, I want to be in a position where I just don't want to get paid. I want people to know, no doubt, that I'm one of the best, and not, if not the best 145ers out there. Because I've been, you know, I've been on a tear, and I've been fighting tough dudes, and I've been proven wrong every single time. So that's the kind of the road I want to take, is really solidify my position in the whole division. Mm-hmm.
Now, if a little kid tells you, Mr. Dawodu, can you beat Holloway or Aldo or Edgar or Palmer or Harrison or even the guys over at Bellator, you know, Georgie Karakanyan and Pitbull, can you beat them yet? Like, and you had to give an honest answer. Are you there yet, Hakeem? Like, or do you still need a little bit more work? Yeah, and eventually you'll get there.
I feel like I'm definitely ready now, you know what I mean? Like, that last fight wasn't even a good showing of how far I've come, you know what I mean? I just took the fight on, you know, 18 days, just, you know, luckily I maintain and I stay in shape all the time. I was able to take it, but I'm definitely ready to fight anybody in the division. I have no doubt in my mind I can put them away, and I'm confident in either whether it's standing or it's whether it's ground. You know, guys keep thinking, you know, it'll take me and Hakeem down and that's how you beat them, but that's not how to beat me no more. So I'm confident I can take anybody in the division.
I love hearing it, man. It was really nice to meet you. Thanks for doing the interview. We'll let you get back to that fettuccine and shrimp pasta you put together.
Yeah,
and hopefully we can catch up again soon.
And, yeah, you know, and when the next move is coming, I'll make sure I'll let everybody know, and we'll do a big announcement.
That's what's up. Folks, give him a follow on Twitter, at MeanHakeemKO. Thanks, Hakeem, for the time.
So thanks for hitting me up, guys.
All right, we'll see you. All right, let's do the quick break, right, Coz?
Yeah, I think
we have to get this one out of the way. And you're listening to MMA Junkie Radio on SiriusXM Rush 93. Shout out to Chuck Wichert for helping us land Mean Hakeem, and we'll be right back after this break.
The power of now is real.
idiot. Yeah, you. Can you please tap that rather large fellow on the shoulder and tell him it's time for more MMA Junkie Radio with Gorgeous George and Goes? Thank you.
All right, my peeps in San Diego, world-class pro MMA is back in your hood, the Observatory North Park on March 25th. Head on down there for some blockbuster night of fights. Doors open at 5 p.m. And it's CFFC 64 that's headed your way. Joining us now to talk about that is the head coach over at Alliance MMA, our good friend Eric Del Fierro. How you doing, Eric?
Del
Fierro, ¿cómo estás?
Man, I'm doing good.
All right.
Del Fierro.
I forgot to emphasize that and roll the R's.
Yeah.
Got
a little bit better this time around, though. It is a little better.
Hey, it was cool to see that picture with you and Bruce, Burt Watson, man. God, we miss Burt. We don't get to see him like we used to. You know, in Vegas, he'd be out here like five, six times a year.
Yeah, it was good to see him better for sure. Mm-hmm. It was awesome.
Yeah, and we know he's now coordinating with you guys. And from what I can tell, because I was on there, it seems like there's still tickets available up close. You know, if you want cage side, and all different types of tickets, VIP options are available. So that was really, really cool to see. But the tickets are still moving as well.
Correct. Correct. Yeah, it's looking good. Like I said, it's a small venue. It's an intimate venue. We're taking it back to the shows that we used to do back here in San Diego, the nightclub ones, and we wanted to keep it intimate like that and see where the market's at for San Diego.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, you know, I've seen a few of these guys. Good. I've seen a few of these guys. I've seen Christian Aguilera over at Bama. Actually, we've called his fights. Great hands, man. Yeah. I really like to see him fight. Danny Davis, local Vegas guy as well. Tough, tough guy. Miles Hunziker, he's co-hosted our show with us as well. So I like how you're finding a balance of up-and-comers and veterans.
Yeah, correct. Well, Miles actually got hurt, so he's off the card. So we actually replaced that fight with another kid. Mm-hmm. And that was actually – I was looking forward to that fight. That was a real even matchup, real talented wrestlers, both of them. So, mm-hmm. So we'll see. We'll see. But regardless, we're able to replace it. We still kept eight pro fights on the card, and I think we're doing about six amateur fights, so it should be good.
Oh, wow. Cool. All right, so there's 14 altogether.
Yes, that's where it should be at, but you know how that goes. Hopefully none of these guys fall out before. Mm-hmm. I forgot about promoting these shows. You know how sometimes guys, last minute, they're like, oh, something hurts. But no, it's going great. But like I said, I've only had one cancellation so far. So yep. It's been good. We got a couple, the Christian Aguilar kid's tough as nails. He's fighting one of my guys, Matt Siles, which is a tough scrapper as well.
Uh-huh.
Let's see. It should be an interesting matchup. That's our main event. Our co-main event, we got Sean Centella fighting Joseph Morales out of Team Alpha Male. Highly touted Uriah Faber kid.
You know, it's cool hearing that nowadays. Now that the gyms have been established and they have, you know, 5 to 10 years, maybe even more under their belt, anytime I hear he's from Team Alpha Male, I already know it's got to be a killer. You know what I mean? Because iron sharpens iron. They've had a really, really good – they're starting to really build a great reputation for, you know, to replace the Benavidez and Dillashaws who went off to San Diego, mm-hmm. Mendez who's on the shelf for another, like, 18 months or so, Faber who retired. But I'm hearing they have some killers out there.
You know what it reminds me of? It shows how far our sport's come along, but it reminds me of when you would see great coaches, say, in the 80s and 90s, and you would hear, here's a new guy, and he's a protege. Of that guy under that system.
Right.
I love hearing that, and I'm hearing that more and more coming out of these camps.
Yeah. And, of course, your gym, Alliance MMA, you know, you talking about Aguilera's opponent, Matt Sales. We're in. I mean, your gym's been on fire for years too.
Yeah, Matt, I think you guys saw Matt Sales fight a couple of years ago out in the World Series of Fighting in Vegas. I think he fought at 45 at that fight. Mm-hmm. Fought a tough little Hawaiian kid. I don't remember his name, but it was a hell of a fight. Mm-hmm. So no, he's a scrapper, man. He brings it for sure. He's one of our top guys. You know, hopefully expect him to make the leap here to the next level.
So how are these days leading up to the card for you? I mean, I got to imagine they are somewhat stressful. The phone has to be on constantly.
Well, you know, the phone is always on constantly, but what's really, it's not the actual show. The thing these guys have created, all the guys from CFFC and Alliance MMA, they literally have a whole structure system. Burt landed here on Monday and literally was on me. Just, I mean, he's running the show. You know what I mean? It's pretty, like, it's almost like they give you a little package and here, Eric, it's simple. This is what you're doing. And it's literally that easy.
they have so many people in place that are making this a lot easier to do than what I used to do when we used to do it, you know, with a couple other people. Mm-hmm. So honestly, it's coming together great. I think my phone's ringing more to see who can get a comp ticket more than anything.
I was just about to ask you about that. Talk a little bit about the VIP package.
VIP seats are $175. The venue itself is very, very small. It's about, I want to say about 1,000 people fit in there. It's a concert venue. It's where all the local acts would go play, and every now and then you get some bigger acts going there. But it's a theater type of arena, I guess you could say. So what we did was we're placing the cage on the stage itself and building seats from there. So the VIP seating is going to be on the stage, and there's a couple of rows on the floor, and then towards the back, it's all standing room only. I don't know if you guys ever had one of my shows down in the Tijuana, Mexico days where we did shows down there. There were more that Valley Tudo type of feel to it, where everybody was just surrounding the cage, and it was like the old Coliseum. We're trying to recreate those type of shows because that's kind of what put us on the map down here in San Diego, and people really follow us. So we're trying to keep a club type of event going on maybe every quarter or so is what we're hoping for.
I miss those shows, George.
Yeah, me too. Do the juices get?
Did you guys make it down there? Did you guys make it to the Tijuana, Mexico shows?
No,
never to the Tijuana ones. It was so cool. It was those type of things where you just kind of wait until you hear from a friend or someone posts on the internet what actually happened. But when you look at some of the guys that went through some of those shows, man, I mean, there's some names out there.
Yeah, we would see the highlights. We were more like King of the Cage guys because we were a little bit further up, you know, by Orange County. So we did King of the Cage. There was a Hitman series. Remember that, goes? There was Total.
Even Tito did a show in Santa Ana. Remember that?
What was the name of the guys in Santa Monica? Total something. Not Santa Total Monica. Recall, Total Fighting, Total something. But I remember we'd go up there and check those out. But we would hear about it. I remember the whole. Remember when Brandon Vera answered Tank Abbott's call out?
Yeah,
that was on your show, right?
That was on our show, yeah. They really got in the cage and started calling him out.
That's crazy. I was going to ask you, do the juices get flowing, you know, for these fight cards just as much as, you know, when you're in there cornering Dominic and Phil, and is it just a fight to fight for you?
No, I tell people this, man. Whether it's a championship fight at the highest level or whether I'm cornering an up-and-comer on a regional show, for me, it's the same excitement. What I mean by that is, your excitement doesn't change when a guy loses, and your heart breaks the same when your heart breaks the same when he loses, and your excitement is the same when they win. It doesn't matter if they win for a world title. Mm-hmm. It's just the win. You know what I mean? At this level, it just you see what they feel. You know what I mean? You're part of it. And the fact coaching is such a different thing that it's hard to explain unless you've been in it, because as a coach, you're sharing knowledge, you're sharing information, and on top of that, you're being a parental figure. You're being a psychologist. You're sharing so much information that when you see these guys at the happiest moment because they accomplish something, it gives you your own happiness to see that. And almost it's almost a gift to know that these people are willing to share this with you. Mm-hmm. So I get the same fun out of cornering these guys at a regional show and, you know, all the way up to the highest shows for sure. And maybe because I've experienced it all, you know, and I just feel same amount of happiness for sure.
Right. For more information, folks, you can go to cffc.tv for the ticket information. For more information on Alliance MMA, go to alliancemma.com. You can follow Eric Del Fiero on Twitter at Eric Del Fiero. Same goes for Instagram. Eric, we got just a couple more minutes left. You know, good luck on the show this Saturday. We're happy to promote. And last thing I wanted to ask you was Dominic Cruz, I guess, you know, have you talked to him, and how's he taking that loss, and when will he be ready to go back and chase his title down?
Oh, he's good. Dominic's good. I mean, you guys seen him around. He stays positive. He does his thing, and he's just, like I said, he's just taking care of his body. He's training, you know, not 100% full-time, but he's in here training and just kind of letting his body heal. With that plantar fasciitis, that seems to be one of the most complicated injuries he's ever had. And I say that because anybody that's had that injury or that condition, it just doesn't go away. And the only thing that really helps it is rest. Mm-hmm. So I think he stated himself, he'd rather just wait for the belt. Whoever's got the belt, that's who he wants next. He's at a point in his career, he's like, hey, you know, I don't need to go all the way down to the bottom of the list and fight all the way up again. I don't, you know, I want to fight the guys that are holding the belt.
You've coached against both. Who do you think? Who do you think comes out of that fight as the winner and the next opponent for Dominic Cruz, Garbrandt or Dillashaw?
I think Cody. Cody's slick. He's slick, and I think what he showed is a lot of composure. Mm-hmm. And he's I think he's got a lot more that he hasn't shown. So I think I don't know. You know, I'm always intrigued about rematches are always difficult, and teammates fighting teammates is. It's a whole different level of mental battle. So the question is who can put it aside more than the other, and I would kind of give that edge to Cody.
Mm-hmm. Also want to wish
But I don't know, you know?
Also want to wish you good luck with Wilson Hayes and Phil Davis. Looks like they have some title fights coming up. Your gym's always packed with superstars. It's just one busy peak weekend after the next. But this weekend at CFFC, 64 out in San Diego, California, and we want to thank you for the time. As always, Coach Eric Del Fiero.
No, thank you guys for having me, man. Thank you guys for having me. I appreciate it.
All right. Take care. We'll see you.
All right, buddy.
All right. Yep. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
All right, folks. Follow him on Twitter at Eric Del Fiero. Hats off to Megan Bush for making that happen. Now we're going to have to bust through these calls because we are nearing the end of the show, but I promised you all you'd have your turn. So let's go one by one by one. It's Proteus in Ontario, Canada. What's up, Proteus?
Good morning, dudes. How are you?
Good, man.
Good, good, good. How are them heads after the big week of NCAA basketball? They all feeling good? Ready for this weekend?
Yeah,
they're cloudy stuff.
Some pounding, yeah, on a few nights, but no, we're veterans. You know what I mean? You start to trickle down with some water and just gear up for the next day. And thank you, by the way, for allowing me to co-host with you, Amp Radio, last week. I had a good time. I had a few in me, so hopefully I didn't babble too much.
No, that's all good. We thank you for coming out for championship rounds with GG. That's awesome of you to do. Quickly, I know, George, you're not interested in this. Just off topic Tuesday for goes. And then I'll get out of here because if you got more on the line. How are your Dodgers looking? How are you feeling about spring training, goes? Feeling all right?
No, we were just talking about this, and I'm not so sure that they made that many improvements in the offseason to get better. But you know, they were only a little bit of a meltdown away from being in the World Series last year. So hopefully they can stay healthy. I think that's the biggest thing for them.
Yeah, right. Cool. And one last thing before we go, because you mentioned the Lance Palmer fight. You know, I had Roberts in that fight, and I thought it was an impressive win for him. We'll see what he's got going forward because that kid's a killer. All right, guys, you have yourselves a great day.
All right, you too, Proteus.
Bye-bye.
As far as the Palmer fight, I thought it might be 2-2. We had NCAA going. There was a lot of stuff going on. But I thought there was a chance it could be 2-2. I didn't have a problem with one judge calling it 3-1 going into the fifth. But Harrison clearly won round five, and he deserved to win that title. Let's go to – I will say I've seen Palmer on the ground with some guys where he looks like he's just worlds above, and I don't understand why he didn't try a little bit more to get it in that world. Yes, I know Harrison can stop a takedown. He's wrestled himself, but – Palmer's just so explosive, and he blends the grappling so well, I would have wanted to see more. Brian from Boston, what's up?
Hey, boys. I had originally called in to talk about that Bellator pay-per-view, and it's almost kind of a crossroads for Bellator of which way they're going to head. You know, are they going to head towards a serious organization now with some of these signings that they've made lately with Bader, Larkin, Rory McDonald? So I think they're going to start to get away from more of the sideshow fights and start heading towards, you know, real cards. But I am a little disappointed, though, that they went and put Chael and Vanderlei at the top of that card. It kind of tells me they're still leaning a little bit towards the sideshow act, where I think you should put Mitrione and Emelianenko at the top of that card and just really try to push that as a legit card versus having those other two guys at the top of the card because they're way behind their front.
All right. Thanks, Brian, for the call. You know, we're going to dive more into that tomorrow. Let me give Dan from Oregon 20 seconds. What's up, Dan? How you doing?
What up, man? Hey, shout-outs to Dan Hardy and that London crowd, that Brad Pickett retirement. I loved it. You know, we all love to watch the sport, to watch him bang bro and all that stuff. But, you know, seeing Mark Munoz and Brad Pickett get these excellent, you know, standing ovations as they exit the sport. That That's another reason why I watch, man. And
all right, brother.
I'm super
I gotta
convinced
move on.
That no one sees Fight Pass.
I got to move on. Good stuff, man. We'll talk more about that when we come back. Thanks to Hakeem Dawodu and Eric DeFerro. We're out of here. Be champions. Las Vegas turning day into night. I'm turning night.